Hello friends, welcome again to our JoCamp page and thank you for your interest. In this series, I'll be shedding some light on some basic principles of sequence stratigraphy. We'll start by looking at possible sources of data for the study of sequence stratigraphy. I will also talk a little bit on some key concepts of sea level change, and then we'll round off with some one or two definitions for sequence stratigraphy. Now, take a look at this section. It kind of shows you different types of data. You have an outcrop section, a seismic section, and a well log. So the whole idea is to point to the fact that we can do, we can carry out sequence stratigraphic studies in the field or using seismic or well data, and in some cases, biostratigraphic data. Now, take a second look again at this and make some observations. So the question here is, what's common to all these different classes of data? So I've gone ahead to put some preliminary interpretations on the outcrop, right, and also on the seismic data, and also on the well log. So key thing is, we see that lines, or rather these surfaces, are actually continuous and areally extensive, especially on the outcrop and seismic section shown. We also see that the units are repetitive. So these are very key things to observe and keep in mind as we progress this course. We also observe that overall within each interval, for example, if you look at the outcrop section or the seismic section shown, we see that within each package, what we have in the unit below doesn't look so different from the one above. So that means there's some kind of, apart from being repeated, within each package, they appear to be genetically related. So in other words, the rock units within each of these interval has some kind of proximity in terms of the environments of deposition. And overall, they all seem to occur in some kind of, separation into sequences bounded by surfaces of discontinuities, which could either be eroding, erosional, or some or non-erosional surface. Now, let's talk a little bit about sea level changes. So some key points to note. Sea level changes actually do occur at both small and large scales at different rates over time. And that has been one thing. So if you look at this plot shown, we see the plot of sea level on the vertical axis against time on the horizontal axis. So we're saying that there is a constant change in the level of the sea. It rises and falls constantly. And depending on the rates at which, the volume of the ocean is changing or some other conditions are changing, it could complete one cycle at different durations. So there could be difference. It could be at fast rate. It could be at much slower rate. But the key thing to note here is we have a cycle where the sea level is falling and another cycle or, phase where the sea level is rising. Another thing to note is that the deposited rock faces depends on the behavior of the sea at a particular time. So when the sea level is falling, it deposits some, faces of rock that belongs to a certain depositional environment. And then when it is rising, it deposits another faces of rock that belongs to another depositional environment. So the depositional environment of the rock faces we find actually tells us whether the sea level was rising or falling at the time it was deposited. So the third point to note is that a rise in the sea level depends, or rather deposits, more offshore rock faces. So we can actually rephrase that to say that each time the sea level is rising, it brings deposits from the distal part of the ocean, more of the offshore fishes, and brings them on towards the land. And the reverse is the case when it is falling. So when the sea level is falling, the deposits we find more are fluvial or estuarine. In other words, they are sediments that have come from the land or from the terrestrial sections or areas and are brought down because the sea level is falling, pulling back, thereby creating room for sediments that were from upland or uphill to make their way towards the where you have the shoreline. The fourth point I've put here is that repetitions in rock facies and stratigraphic depositional sequences can be tied to, one, the fluctuation in the sea level, and also the position in the global sea level cycle. So in other words, the repetitions we see in those in the earlier section I've shown in the well and the seismic sections, they actually tell us that the sea level was changing very rapidly locally. And also, the depositional sequence we see, we'll talk more about depositional sequences in the coming episodes or coming slides. But the depositional sequence that we see is actually a function of the position of the that the phase of the global sea level cycle in which the rocks were in during their deposition. So another important question we ask is, what causes sea level change? Now, these questions are quite important because it helps us get a bigger picture or a much larger view of cause and effect. What causes this and how does it relate to this? Just like we talked about sea level changes having direct impact on what is deposited, or the direction of sea level having some direct impact on what kind of or what environments or what species of rock are deposited from what environment. So in this very slide, we're saying, what are the causes of sea level change? Because this is important to help us really appreciate a bit of a bigger picture before we narrow down to the well logs and the higher resolution data. So now, firstly, glaciers and ice sheets melting. So the key word here is melting, right? Of course, that obviously increases the volume of water in the ocean. Secondly, the ocean warming. Of course, the idea there is the water either it contracts or expands depending on the temperature, and that has some direct impact on the volume of water in the ocean. Subsidence in the deltaic sections where you have maybe landslides or some local tectonics, and maybe in some other cases, plate movements, a bit of larger scale here. It also impacts the volume of space available for water to occur, to occupy, and in effect, the volume of water in a particular ocean basin. We also, from researches done by several people, storm surges and variations in the behavior of the ocean waters in terms of circulation. It also has direct impact on the volume of water in the ocean. And finally, the terrestrial sources of water can also have some huge or small impacts depending on how much of water is coming in into the ocean basin. So now this is an example of a chronostratigraphic chart, but this is for the Niger Delta Basin. Here we're seeing actually the key surfaces and their ages. The idea is to show that the sea level has been changing through time constantly. If you look at the charts in the middle section, you see variations in the shoreline position, especially in the basinal or in the basin ward part of this section. And each of those actually represents changes in the sea level. And also we see surfaces that mark periods when we had a rapid reduction or a rapid increase in the sea level. Okay, so let's maybe close out with one or two definitions of sequence stratigraphy. The first definition that I like a lot is the simplest one. And it's actually from a friend, Tunde, which we had a chat recently, and he just mentioned that sequence stratigraphy is, should be the stratigraphy in sequences. And I think I like that. I actually put it stratigraphy in depositional sequences, or stratigraphy of depositional sequences. But the key thing is, we have looked at, the previous sections I showed. We see rocks in different packages or in different repeated sequences. The idea is, when we look at them as a whole, as one unit, using stratigraphic concepts, maybe that is what sequence stratigraphy is. The second definition is, I try to put that together to say it's a science of placing, repetitive sedimentary beds into genetically associated packages bounded by surfaces in time and space. So the key thing here is sedimentary beds, repetitive sedimentary beds that are genetically associated, putting them together into distinct packages such that they are bounded by surfaces in 3D dimension. So this is another possible way to look at sequence stratigraphy, and this is actually the complicated one, the long one rather. So it says a branch of geology or stratigraphy that examines the timing and 3D arrangements of repeated sedimentary beds or deposits into distinct packages or sequences, such that each sequence represents records of the relative sea level behavior and available accommodation space. So here again, the key points which we've highlighted here are timing. So there's a concept of timing in sequence stratigraphy. There's a concept of arrangement of the different strata. And then we should also keep in mind that the units are repeated and they are genetically related. So each of these genetically related units are actually put into blocks called sequences, in a way that each sequence gives us information about the behavior of the sea at that time and the amount of accommodation space available for the sediments to occupy or to fill in. Okay? So that's where I'll cut it for now. In our next module, we'll talk more on some of these concepts that I mentioned, accommodation space, the concept of eustasy, and how to identify changes in sea level from data. Thank you very much for listening. If you have questions, please don't hesitate to send me an email, ifequire@yahoo.com. And you can also chat us up on YouTube and Facebook page, joecamp_ifineob. All right, thank you very much for your time.